video's not my expertise, so I just wanted to give you some information about how one goes about upgrading to 4K for a projector system. Obviously, if you're using a broadcast television, it's kind of automatic. You don't really need to do anything. But if you're using a projector, things can get tricky because projectors have to use a switcher for the video signal, etc., and all that gets really tricky. A few definitions in case people aren't aware. What is 4K? 4K refers to the number of pixels across the screen. Now, that's different than the old-fashioned usage of 720, 1080, because that referred to the number of scan lines. In other words, that was the number of rows that the screen would have. Does anybody know why we changed from talking about scan lines to pixels?
It's because the advertising department wants a bigger number.
Bigger number, yeah,
it's
bigger.
The difference between professional designations and consumer designations. All the 1080, 720, and whatever twice 1080 is, are consumer designations. 2K is a professional designation for a line scanner that scans motion picture film. These have been around for 20 years and more.
When I'm talking about 4K, there's 4K pixels across, but there's only 2160 lines. So in the professional designation, that would be 2K.
No, that's the professional designation is horizontal measurement only.
I thought, professional's always been horizontal, but consumer's been vertical.
Yeah.
I see. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
But yeah, I agree. The 4K probably had to do with it's a bigger number, so let's go that way. So anyways, basically 4K has four times the resolution of 1080p, so that's a significant upgrade. But also, the next upgrade is that my projector is HDR, which is high dynamic range, which means that each pixel, instead of being 8 bits, is 10 bits. That's the current standard in high definition. So we have two upgrades from the old-fashioned 1080p. One is we have more pixels, and now we have a better bit depth on each pixel. The net result is it is a monumentally better picture. It's obvious when you see it. You'll realize this is not the old-fashioned 1080p. To me, I have to use a projector because my interest is film. I've always been interested in film. I made a film in college. Film is my passion, and in film, the speakers have to be behind the screen. Anytime I go somewhere and I see a television, I can tell the audio is right and left to beside the picture, and either the center channel is either below or above, and it bothers me. I can't take that. To me, the three speakers have to be behind the screen because that's the way it's done. That's the way the film is mixed. That's the way you see it anytime you go to a film theater. If you want to see film the way it's meant to be done, you have to use a screen, and it has to be an acoustically transparent screen. Now, for those of you who don't know, I did a lot of work in screens because I wanted the speakers behind the screen. But when I did some measurements, I discovered that my acoustically transparent screen was terrible, and I mean terrible. The attenuation was about 6 decibels. It looked like peaks and troughs. I mean, the sound coming through that acoustically transparent screen was terrible. So what I eventually did was, is I used a white bed sheet. It's about 200, 300 threads per inch, and as, I guess Byrne left, but as Byrne was talking about, he was wondering why we didn't see a moiré pattern between the 4K and this, and I said, well, if you multiply 200, 300 inches by 120 inches across, you'll see that I have a lot more threads than I have pixels, so the thread density is much, much higher than the pixel density, and you're not going to get a moiré pattern. And sure enough, you know, he admitted there wasn't one. I later found out, and this is curious, if you want to read this article, look up my name in the AES and then on waveguides, and then look at the article right after mine. And it's on these Japanese who did research the exact same problem, and that was audio coming through a screen. And their solution was, is they had developed a fabric that worked perfectly. Thing is I found my perfect fabric at the local, not Home Depot, but what's that?
Bed Bath & Beyond.
Bed Bath & Beyond.
Bed Bath & Beyond, exactly. Bed Bath & Beyond. So basically, you just take an old bed sheet, you stretch it around a frame. Now, the frame should be circular tubing. You don't want diffraction around that frame. And then you stretch it and you lightly spray it down with water. And when it dries, it will pull taut. Then you suspend it and you have a very good screen. That worked well for a long time, but then I discovered that I was getting too much light through the screen, back off the wall, and back through. So I put a second layer of black fabric behind the first layer. The black fabric is probably only 20 thread per inch, or maybe even 20 or 50, something like that. It's very, very porous, so there's virtually no acoustic loss there. But it's very effective for light. It doesn't let much light through for some reason. So basically, that bumped the contrast ratio up considerably. So that's the screen I'm using, and I swear by that. I've not seen any better screens than what I have. And although you can certainly pay a lot for these acoustically transparent screens, it's a real scam out there. So I'd for a long time wanted to go to 4K. I realized I'd seen 4K televisions, and I realized that 4K television was a big jump, and I wanted 4K for my system, but I had to wait for a projector because I was not going to buy a screen. It just wouldn't suit me. Finally, Optima came out with a 4K projector that was $2,200, which was quite attractive because that's something that I could consider. Coincidentally, that projector today is $1,800. So these prices are dropping, and I've only had my projector about 3 months, 4 months, something like that. So in 3 or 4 months, it's dropped $400. I mean, these prices is crazy. You can't even keep track of them anymore. The Optima UHD 60, and it's an excellent, excellent piece of equipment. They have a cheaper 4K projector, but it doesn't use the same chip. I don't believe it's HDR. I think it has an 8-bit video processor. So they had to do a new video processor to upgrade it to 10 bits. That cost you a little bit more money, but it's worth it. However, I put the projector up and it didn't work. The first thing I found out was that the HDMI cable was directional. Who'd ever heard of a directional HDMI cable? I mean, I had no idea that there were directional HDMI cables. Sure enough, you look on the HDMI cable and it says in really, really, really small print, projector. But that was at the receiver side. So that was my first problem. So then I had to pull all this out, reverse the cable, put it on the projector side. This was after calling the people and asking them, why doesn't my cable work? You know, if I route a cable independent of this one, it works, but this one doesn't work. Well, did you put it in the right, going the right direction? I said, direction? Since when has HDMI been directional? Well, it is now. So you have to be careful of that, because if you want to go 4K using HDMI cable, they have to be directional. I believe that's true. Now, it may only be true because mine's a 30-foot cable. And 30-foot may have to have gain.
Active.
Is that the case?
Active cable.
It's an active cable. So in an active cable, you have to plug the right end into the right end.
Does it have an amplifier built into it?
I think it has an amplifier built into it. But anyways, nobody tells you these things, right? When you're out there, you have to find this stuff out for yourself. So I switched the cable around, and it worked fine, except for 4K. It wouldn't work for 4K. Some more research finds out that to do 4K using an HDMI cable, you have to have HDCP 2.2. Well, 2.2 only exists on the very latest receivers. In other words, if your receiver hasn't been built in the last year, it probably doesn't have HDCP 2.2. It probably has 2.1. Well, 2.1 won't pass a 4K signal because it doesn't meet the protection requirements. So I had to get a new receiver. I had to get a new receiver, take the old receiver, which, thank God, I was glad to get rid of that one. I'll make a second complaint here about Yamaha that was the worst piece of electronic equipment I ever bought in my whole life, was that Yamaha receiver. I'd never owned a Yamaha receiver, but it was highly rated, except that it didn't do any of the stuff it was supposed to do, and it did a whole bunch of stuff I didn't want, and it was outrageously expensive to boot. So selling that on eBay, even though I lost a lot of money, was well worth it. So then I bought a less expensive receiver, but works probably a lot better than the Yamaha. It's a Panasonic. They seem to do a pretty good job. It has HDCP 2.2 and will play 4K, except that the 4K projector came with a Roku unit. The Roku unit wouldn't work. It would not sink in. It wasn't stable. It kept dropping out. I kept calling Roku, writing the projector people. I never got it resolved. Basically, I threw the Roku unit away. Don't recommend Roku, especially if you're going 4K. I had never got it to work right. I could get it to work for a little bit, but then it would always drop out. Something would happen. You're in the middle of a movie and the Roku stops working. The only way around it is you got to reboot it. Not for me. Fire TV. Now, Fire TV works excellent. Fire TV always works. It works well. And when you're watching 4K on a Fire TV unit, it is exceptional. And so, obviously, I strongly recommend if you go 4K, go with Amazon Fire TV. It's the only solution I found that worked. Except that I do a lot of stuff on my PC, and I wanted my PC to be 4K as well. Well, the video card was capable of 4K, except that it wouldn't sync to the projector at 4K because the video card wasn't fast enough. So I found out that you had to go to I use an NUC, which is a little computer in a box, and the video processor is mounted on the motherboard, and it's actually built into the Intel chipset. Well, to get the Intel chipset that will run HDCP 2.2 at 4K resolution, you have to buy an i7. Only the i7 will work. It's the only chip that has that speed and capability. So I had to upgrade my NUC to a new NUC using an i7. Fortunately, it's a lot faster and it's better, but needless to say, I thought I was buying a new projector. I didn't realize I was buying a whole new system, basically from end to end. There was not one piece of equipment that I still owned except the power amplifiers and my speakers. I didn't change those. Except I did take advantage of redoing this to remeasure the system and make sure it was all working fine, and I found that there were a number of mistakes. I mean, it's amazing how many times you can do something and yet still find mistakes in what you've done in the past. So I re-equalized the system, checked all of the EQ, I redid the base EQ per my presentations here before, and I found that even the audio improved because of the mistakes I had made. And so now I'm comfortable that the system is working top notch. And I think those of you who will witness it will agree. Was it worth it? I don't know. It depends on how much work and money you want to put into things. I mean, obviously my home theater is a big part of my life. There isn't a day goes by I'm not down there watching it. So it's a big part of my life. And it was important to me to have state-of-the-art. So that was my brief presentation. And any questions or comments? Or
talk a little more about sources. For instance, Blu-ray disc, okay? How far does that go toward?
I don't know. I don't have a Blu-ray disc. I only stream, and I kind of gave up on any of that other stuff before, but you can stream quite a bit of 4K in Amazon. Amazon only releases 4K anymore, so anything that Amazon releases not from now on will be 4K. Amazon has made a commitment to 4K, and that is their commitment. So any of the Amazon series that you watch are all in 4K now. So all of their releases, all of their seasons from now on will be 4K. HBO is upgraded to HDR, but they have not upgraded to 4K, and they have not made an announcement when they're going to do that, except that rumor is that HBO will be 4K by the end of the year. They are HDR now. So the source material, while it may be a little limited at this point, another year from now, pretty much anything you want.
Yeah, I actually did a little bit of research before I came here today, reading about 4K projectors. Apparently, some of the projectors aren't true 4K. What they do is they sort of like do a...
This one's true 4K.
All right. Can you explain a little bit about...
Well, some of the cheaper ones, what they do is they shift the mirror back and forth so that they can simulate 4K. Basically, it's interlaced. I don't know whether that's worth it or not. I just know that mine has not done that way. I've not heard good or bad things about that. I suspect it's not really very attractive because it's not very popular. It's not very common, that's for sure. Yeah.
Now, based on the size of the screen, when does 4K become, more necessary?
Screen my size is definitely necessary. And this is one of the issues, is that, for instance, 4K on my TV in here, which is 52 inches, at normal viewing distances, your eye could not see the difference between the resolution. I have a 120-inch screen downstairs. At the distance I'm at, about 10 feet, you can definitely see the difference between 1080p and 4K. And that's proven out even by the mathematics. From what we know about the eye's resolution, that is the case. It's seriously questionable whether in any home system going above 4K would be practical.
Is this all about phasing out the old technology that's been tried and true throughout the ages we've come?
I can't say.
After that everything hits 4K, they're just going to dump everything else off?
All I can say is that the difference between 1080p and 4K to me is quite demonstrable. A lot of that might be the difference between 8-bit and 10-bit, because that's quite noticeable too. The higher dynamic range is definitely noticeable. You're not going to see a 4K picture that isn't HDR. So whether you're seeing 4K, the higher resolution, or whether you're seeing the higher dynamic range, it's hard to say which of those is the most impressive. But the upgrade is impressive.
Regarding acoustically transparent cloth, this is like the low caveman approach. I went to Joann Fabrics when I was redoing a set of speakers, and I just listened to the music, the Muzak, and I was coming over to, and I took various samples of cloth I thought were potential candidates, and I draped them over my head to see if there was any blockages of any frequencies causing some alarm to the little old ladies who were shopping for fabric there. But I came up with like some... Yeah, it was a reasonable way.
My technique was even simpler, although I wouldn't have done it in front of people, but I just blew through the cloth. You can feel how much wind comes through, and that's a direct relationship to the acoustic resistance. It's a one-to-one.
Does the thread count correlate, or is it the weight of the cloth that matters?
Audio guy. I thought thread count was everything, right? I don't know. All I know is that thread count is listed on the cloth, but the weave type is never shown. Not that I know of.
Does it matter what the fabric is, like if it's polyester, or cotton,
or silk?
I don't think so.
No.
I don't think so. It might. It's a good question. I mean, I didn't test it. I think if the thread count is low enough, it wouldn't matter, but... I'm sure mine's polyester.
Okay.
It's not cotton.
The pixel shifting gives you double the pixels rather than four times.
Right, that's true.
That's a sort of like 3K compromise in between. And speaking of that, you refer to it as four times the resolution. That's always been a sore point for me. It's two times the resolution, which is measured.
You're right, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right.
Four times the pixels.
Four times the pixels, twice the resolution.
And I noticed the magazines do that.
Yep.
About it, and they kind of poo-pooed it.
You're 100% correct. I stand corrected.
More questions?
Let's see it.
Yeah.
So we'll take the first group of people downstairs and...
Find it.
six. You didn't sign up for six, I mean, I'm not in that.
Come on.
Come on. Where's our last guy?
You got a certain spot here.
Okay. I should go off.
I don't know what did this before, right? It's listed 1080p and then it switched.
Here we go.
Remember?
Not sure about this.
Oh, yeah, yeah, it is. And that's what I say, since there's no such thing as 4K without HDR, how do you know which it is that's improved?
Yeah, but this is the first time I found an improvement with the glass. Otherwise, the error of whatever hits you. And even with your audio, you can tell the myriad edits in the narration. It's like she's starting over in the middle of phrases, just cut, 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 cut,
but
which is typical.
What I don't, what bothers me, and I think this is in the film, is you notice that, you notice how the center channel vocal drops in level there's a strong background.
Yeah.
That's not me, right?
No.
That's
no.
them.
That's them mixing.
Yeah, that's them mixing.
Not quite getting it dialed in.
Right, because there's no reason that they can't keep the center channel just as loud.
But with all the different takes.
Takes.
The voice, if it's an hour later, the voice changes a little bit, and suddenly your apparent average level is a little different. And if you don't really get through that by ear.
One of the things I always say is, as you get your system better and better, get prepared for finding all the flaws in the source material.
Exactly.
One of my favorite songs has always been Moondance.
Mm-hmm.
Until I got a really good set of speakers and I listened to Moondance and realized, that guy's clipping his microphone.
Yeah.
I never heard it before.
The early Beatles, I started to hear all the edits and stuff.
Exactly.
And
go, oh, exactly.
This is better.
And you can't get away from that.
No, it's
part of the experience. You got to get used to it.
But thank you for raising the bar.
The contrast ratio, you're referring to the number they record, which I have no idea has any meaning, and all I know is that it's never correlated with anything I've noticed. What correlates with what I've noticed is the black behind the screen increased the contrast ratio. To me, the contrast ratio would only mean something to a screen that was 100% reflective. As soon as you have a screen that's not 100% reflective, the contrast ratio of that would become meaningless, if you think about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's not the limiting factor, that is.
Yeah, there's certainly other, or the light in the room.
The light in the room,
right.
Exactly.
You have to have
so
everything
so these contrast ratios they quote for the projector in the real
what
world
really
have no relevance.
Yeah, the 4K chips compared.
I have no idea. I never look at that.
Yeah.
To me, it's a
because
meaningless.
That's always been the limitation is the TI chip.
It's always been the limitation to people who want to point out that number has some meaning. I don't think that number has any meaning. Not to me, it doesn't.
I agree, Earl, that number has no meaning.
It has no meaning.
Well, I think it has a relative value.
It has a meaning
but
only
there are,
in the
1080.
But there are, but there are people who make different numbers out of the same bloody projector.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but they're all using the same chip.
Well, because, no.
Yeah,
but
because
it's
they're
not
making
the
same.
It's also not the chip.
But I have the old chip, he has the new chip.
It also has to do with the optics of your system. How much leakage is there through the lens from the optics of your system? So the same chip could produce different contrast ratio numbers in a controlled experiment by the way they do the optical system. But again, the limiting factor is going to be the screen and the walls. And that's going to dwarf. And there's no way these walls and screen have anywhere near a 10,000-to-1 contrast ratio. That's huge. Your walls would be not only black, but they'd have to be black felt. And then your screen would have to be 100% reflective. Then you might see a 10,000-to-1 contrast ratio. But unless you're willing to do that,
Well, my current projector isn't 10,000 anymore.
I think that's what this one is. They advertise that, but I pay no attention to that.
Earl, one of the advantages of HDR is you have so much extra brightness in the screen that your eye closes down, which gives you a subjective feeling of your contrast.
It's a good point.
My last projector was way brighter than the old one, so that the apparent bright iris could close down.
But you can control that. I mean, that's a controllable factor, right?
Well, the projector's a factor in that.
So anyways, let's get on with the next demo.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.